Well, we've spent some time looking at Genesis 1:1 and the absolute beginning. And I promise we're not going to take this long working through the whole of Genesis, but it's very important to hit Genesis 1:1 and 1:2 as thoroughly as we're able, because it frames foundationally what we're going to see about the substance of the image of God and the covenant of works and so on. Now, what I want us to do next is I want us to think now in light of Genesis 1:2, and I want us to think of the presence of the Holy Spirit in this glory temple that we've thought about. So I'm going to just try to represent that glory temple again now in terms of this upper register realm. And I want us to talk especially about the presence of the Holy Spirit, Genesis 1:1 and 1:2, and how the Spirit's glory relates to that realm of worship and adoration that we just saw earlier is the highest heaven. So the Holy Spirit now dwelling in what we're going to call the heavenly temple that we saw from Nehemiah 9, Isaiah 6, and other texts. Now, the creation of the highest heavens, as we've said, that's the primal place of the dwelling of God's glory. And the original dwelling place of that glory is found particularly as we move into Genesis 1:2, particularly, it is the dwelling place of the Spirit's glory. The dwelling place of the Spirit's glory. As Isaiah 66:1 makes clear, heaven is my throne, earth is my footstool. But now we are thinking in terms of the glory and the presence of the Spirit dwelling in that realm. Now, it's especially here that I want us to revisit a text that we looked at earlier from Psalm 102, verses 1 and 2. A tent dwelling. The heavens, the highest heavens, are stretched out like a tent that the Lord dwells in. Turn to a text that is of special interest to us in Psalm 104, verses 1 and 2. Notice this. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O Lord my God. You are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretching out the heavens like a tent. Not only is the upper register of glory, the highest heavens, not only is it a heavenly temple dwelling, but it's likened to the dwelling of the tent. The Lord stretched out the heavens as a tent, and there he dwells in glory, cloaked as it were with light. Now, this language of stretching out the heavens like a tent is drawn from the Mosaic covenant. It brings into view that tent dwelling of God in the presence of his people. When the Levitical high priest under the Mosaic covenant wore garments of splendor and glory, they entered into an earthly tent that was pitched under Moses at the direction of God. And what would they do? They would mediate through blood the presence of God to his people. The high priest, clothed with garments of splendor and glory, Deuteronomy 28:2, would enter into the tent dwelling of God with blood not their own, so that a holy God could dwell in the midst of a holy people, an unholy people, through blood, by which they could become what? Consecrated to God and cleansed by the blood that typified the coming Christ. What's the point? Well, the point is that under that old covenant, God's glory would dwell in the midst of his people as he pitched a tent and dwelled in their midst. That tent dwelling, contrary to all forms of dispensational theology, that tent dwelling that comes to be the temple is in its very nature an ectype or copy of the original tent dwelling of God in the presence and person of the Spirit in heaven. The original tent pitched by God is a heavenly and not an earthly one. And so the Shekinah glory of God's Spirit would dwell in the midst of his people, and he would say, I am your God, and you are my people. And they would worship and adore God through blood sacrifice mediated by a priest dressed in garments of splendor and glory, pointing the people where? To the glory of the dwelling of God in a tent. And here is the question that we need to be thinking about. Who dwells in that tent? Whose glory is made known in that original tent? It is the glory of the presence of the Spirit. In Genesis 1:2, which we're going to get to, the Spirit, remember, hovers in avian form over the primal waters of the tohu vavohu, of the formless void of the earth. But he hovers from above. He hovers from this archetypal heavenly dwelling where his presence fills that realm with the glory of God. God, Psalm 104, 2, wraps himself with light as a garment and stretches it out like a tent. Think of it this way. Where do you look to find the original hovering glory presence of God so that he might be worshiped and adored? Where do you look? To heaven, to the abode of the Spirit in his glory. See, as we think about it, the creation of the highest heavens as the temple dwelling of God, that is the place where we find the glory of the Spirit setting that place ablaze with the glory of the triune God. The garment of light is associated most clearly in light of Genesis 2 with the Spirit of God. The Spirit stretching out the heavens, dwelling in those heavens as a tent. That is what Meredith Klein in God, Heaven, and Harmageddon, he calls it an epiphany. An epiphany of the Spirit. The Spirit, I want you to think of it this way. No sooner is that tent pitched, no sooner is that temple created, than the Spirit, listen, epiphanically, instantaneously envelops that place with glory. You see? What happens under the theocracy with Moses? What happens under the theocracy with Solomon when the glory of God dwells in that temple? That is not the original primal place of the Spirit's glory and the epiphany of his presence. The place you look for that is heaven, stretched out like a tent where the Spirit dwells in glory. The absolute beginning of Genesis 1:1 is put in the context of the Spirit making that place into a royal dwelling place. So let me give you this, and you think about it with me. The highest heavens are only a temple dwelling because of the Spirit's presence there. It is the presence of the Spirit, the presence of the glory of God in the Spirit that sanctifies that realm and sets it apart as a holy place, as a place where God is made known in his glory to be worshiped and adored. But it is the Spirit. You can think of creation, think of it this way, as the Spirit entering in his royal glory to fill the heavenly temple and the royal dwelling place of God, what will come to be known in later idiom as Mount Zion itself, the city of the great God, the city of the great King. You see? An epiphany is simply a self-revelation of the glory of God in the person of the Spirit, and that Spirit dwelling is in heaven primarily, first and foremost. It is there that the Spirit entered the realm He had created. So, to dwell on the Spirit's presence is to dwell on heaven. Do you see the connection? Meredith Klein, in one of my favorite things I read from him years ago, pneumatology, the person and work of the Spirit, that is the realm of eschatology, the place where God's glory dwells permanently. You see? Now, just because this is the case, Psalm 104, reflecting on Genesis 1-2, portrays the luminous glory of the Spirit of God, not in redemptive but creational categories, not in earthly but heavenly categories. The creational and the heavenly precedes the redemptive and the earthly. That is central. So what do you start to see coming together here? A God-centered concern is a spirit, heaven-centered concern. To be concerned about the glory of the triune God means that you must be concerned about the realm that glory radiates. And that realm that radiates the glory of God is the place where the Spirit abides. Spirit and heaven are joined inseparably in the economy of creation. Do you see it? It is the place where God is to be glorified and worshiped. So, in the creation event itself, Genesis 1:1, the immutable, self-contained, living Spirit of God fills that realm with glory and power and the presence of God, causing the angelic host to break out in worship and adoration in the Spirit. But it's not only that the Spirit dwells in heaven, making it a holy place. It is that the act of creating the heavenly temple, it is the Spirit's permanent presence there that makes heaven heavenly, that makes heaven the place of worship and glory, and ultimately, at the end of the creation week, rest, Sabbath rest. This is the beginning that Sabbath rest is going to be the consummation of, God dwelling in heaven. Now, here's what I want you to do then. I want you to think about this with me. There are two categories drawn from redemptive history that help illumine what is being said here. The first one, I'd like you to turn to Exodus 40. Exodus 40, 33 through 38. And then we're going to look at a second text from Deuteronomy 32, 10 through 11. Exodus 40, 33 through 38. Listen. And he erected the court around the tabernacle and the altar and set up the screen of the gate of the court. So Moses finished the work. That, by the way, that's an allusion to God finishing his creative work on the during the creation week. Now, redemptive recreation under Moses is being typified, right? Now look, 34. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle in such a way that Moses was driven away by the luminous, glorious, awesome presence of God. Could not enter into it. Throughout all their journeys, verse 36, whenever the cloud, The cloud, by the way, is the Spirit's Shekinah glory presence. It's the glory cloud, as Klein would say. When that cloud was taken up from over the tabernacle, the people would set out. But if the cloud was not taken up, they did not set out till that day it was taken up. For the cloud of the Lord was on the tabernacle by day, and fire was in it by night in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout their journeys. What does that mean? Let me tell you what it means. It means that Israel, under Moses, saw a visual display of the glory of God entering a copy of heaven right before their eyes. And that glory is a redemptive recapitulation of this glory, of this primal glory, where the Spirit did not enter into a tent made with hands, but He entered into the tent He Himself spread in the heavens for His glory to be made known and for His name to be confessed and adored. The glory of the Lord covered the tent of meeting, and the Shekinah glory, the settling or dwelling of the Spirit's glory, filled that place. And God, by the glory of His Spirit presence, bound Himself to His people and His people to Himself in a bond of communion and fellowship. That is a redemptive and typical reenactment of Genesis 1:2. And it's an anticipation of the climactic consummation of the Spirit's work in the midst of God's people through the promised Messiah, Old Covenant, the ascended Messiah, New. It is from that lofty dwelling place in heaven that the Spirit descended to fill the earthly replica. Do you see? Second example, Deuteronomy 32:10-11. Deuteronomy 32:10-11. This is a commentary on the Exodus out of Egypt. And I want to set the Exodus in light of one of my favorite texts as a preface to Exodus 32:10-11. You might know it well. In Exodus 19:4, when God brings His people through blood under Moses out of Egypt and is bringing them to the promised land, how does Exodus 19:4 describe that event? It says that I brought you on eagle's wings to myself. The Exodus out of Egypt, far from being simply a geographical change from Egypt to Canaan, is a bringing of God's people to God Himself on the wings of an eagle. The hovering over of the Spirit of God. The cloud by day, the fire by night, is the dwelling of God in His glory with His people. And the avian imagery in Exodus 19:4 makes your mind turn to what? The hovering Spirit filling the highest heavens with the glory of God as the place where His presence always abides to protect those who worship Him. Do you see? That hovering presence on eagle's wings and bringing a people to Himself to see His glory harkens back to that primal dwelling of the Spirit in the highest heavens. And Deuteronomy 32:10-11 speaks of what? God brings His people to Himself and says in 32:9, my portion is Israel, my people, my covenant people. And where does God bring them? He brings them out of Egypt through a howling waste which is language borrowed directly from Genesis 1-2, the tohu vavohu, the formless void, the spirit that comes from the heavenly temple, hovering over the primal waters of creation. That spirit hovered over Israel, bringing Israel out of Egypt through the Red Sea into the promised land. And that hovering is a protective hovering. That hovering is the spirit presence of God with his people. And it invokes precisely the language here of the spirit who hovers and comes to hover over the primal waters of creation. That glory of the spirit is associated with that realm greater than Canaan, of which Canaan is a what? A type and a replica. God dwells with his people on earth, even as the Spirit dwells in the glory of heaven. This is the point. You can even put it this way, that the Spirit from the Father and the Son, revealing glory to the people on earth, is reminding them of what? That this earthly hovering over of the Spirit, this redemptive movement, it's bringing into view heaven as the ultimate abode of the people of God. The ultimate place where God dwells in heaven. And so as we think about this, I want to tell you just a couple of points that I think are worth making here. First, and to reiterate this, just to make clear, the Spirit and heaven, listen, are inseparably and permanently joined. What God has joined, let no theologian separate. Right? The presence of God in the Spirit is annexed inseparably and irrevocably to heaven. That is what we must remember. Second point is that this inseparable is also permanent. Meredith Klein goes so far as to say this, and this is in God, Heaven, and Armageddon. The Spirit, he coined a verb, is indoxated in this heavenly temple. Now, let me tell you what he means. He has a wonderful vocabulary that's sometimes quite original to himself. And if you spend time reading it, you'll start to see what he's after. But what does it mean to be indoxate? Well, let me tell you. It means if you are God, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, it means, listen, that wherever you dwell, doxology must attend. Doxology must attend. It's not an option. The only conceivable response of creatures is to fall before the thrice holy God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and worship and adore him for his sake alone. So that what you get is not the coming of an earthly king to be coronated on an earthly throne. What you have is the Spirit of God coming into the heavenly temple, and in that realm he is indoxate. He is present to be worshiped as the one who bears all glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, intensively and uniquely disclosed in the personal presence of the Spirit. That's what the foundations here from theologians like Voss and Klein lead us to say. So think back now to the texts we surveyed about the highest heavens, Nehemiah 9:6. What did the angelic host worship? They worshiped God as he made himself known in the glory of his Spirit. Worship is in spirit and truth. and the original glory presence of God in the Spirit, it is the Spirit's glory that caused the heavenly hosts to fall before God in worship. It is the Spirit's glory, or the glory of the Father and the Son in the Spirit, that caused the seraphim to cover their eyes and to cover their feet and to fly singing in response to one another in doxology to God. So you see, creatures, whether angels or men, whether image bearer or angel, are made for one overarching and fundamental purpose. It is to declare the praise and bask in the glory and receive full creaturely satisfaction from God Himself. And the way God makes Himself known is by the Spirit speaking through the Word in the Scriptures. And the Word of God in Genesis 1 and now 2, as we're moving toward the creation of the visible heavens and earth, the Spirit's presence is the presence of the one who demands doxology, who demands worship. And the natural, prior to the fall, the natural response of the image bearer, which we'll move to soon, is just that spontaneous, whole-souled worship of the one who is the glory of God in the personal presence of the Spirit. What we'll do tomorrow and the day after is we'll have to think about, as the Spirit hovers over the primal waters of creation, Genesis 1:2, He's going to form the heavens and the earth as what? Once you see this, it's quite useful. He is going to create the heavens and the earth as a visible replica of the glory in those highest heavens. So that whether you look at the sky or the trees or the sea or the grass or whatever else is in this world, where is your mind turned? Upward to the glory of God in that heavenly realm that this lower earthly visible heavens and earth replicates. And what is Eden going to be? Well, I'll tell you, just so we can continue in earnest tomorrow, Eden is going to be the concentrated focus of God's approach to man to make that glory known on earth so that those on earth might come to be translated and raised through perfect obedience and worship into the heavenly, glorious presence and to see the glory of the Spirit writ large in that heavenly tabernacle and respond appropriately. And we'll look at that and start moving toward Eden, creation of the image of God, and covenant in our next lesson.